So hey guys, I'm back with another video. In this video, we are going to learn about the third phase of judicial administration in the Madras Presidency. So without further ado, let's roll the intro. Let's look at the Admiralty Court, which was established in the third phase of judicial administration in Madras Presidency. So this court was established in 1686, and this court, it went on till 1726, when the Charter of 1726 was passed. I have already uploaded a video regarding the Charter of 1726, whatever its provisions. If you have not checked out that video, please go ahead. I will also provide the link here in the I button, so you can go ahead and check out that video. We find that this Admiralty Court, it was started because there was an increase in the crime. Since Madras was a developing town, the trade was increasing, the population was increasing, that's why more shops were coming up, there were people who were coming from various villages nearby. That's why we find that there was an increase in the crime which was taking place in this Madras Presidency, and that is why the British government, it thought that for the need to control this crime, control this increasing menace of crime, they passed the 1686 Charter. This court, Admiralty Court, it consisted of three senior most servants of the company, and one of them was judge of the Admiralty Court, and two others acted as the assistants. The chief judge of Admiralty Court was called the judge advocate. Sir John Biggs, he was appointed as the first judge advocate, and he was an expert in civil law. In 1687, we also find two new offices were introduced. First was the office of Attorney General, and second was the office of Registrar. These two offices were introduced in 1687 after the passing of 1686 Charter. Let us look at what was the jurisdiction of this Admiralty Court. This Admiralty Court handled mercantile cases, maritime cases. Maritime cases means the cases which took place while the voyages used to take place. Like if a voyage is taking place from, let's say, Madras to Jakarta in Indonesia. So while traveling, while the voyage was taking place, if some crime used to happen on the ship while they were on the seas, then these cases were handled by this Admiralty Court. Mercantile cases were related to trade related practices. Civil cases and as well as criminal cases were also handled by this Admiralty Court. And this Admiralty Court, it acted as the appeal court from Mayor's Court. So it also heard the appeals which used to come from the Mayor's Court. We find that in 1689, John Biggs died, and Governor and Council, they decided to appoint the Governor himself as the judge advocate, and two other members who were present in the Admiralty Court, they were replaced by the members of the Council of the Governor. This way we find that the judiciary as well as executive, it became one, because in judiciary also we find the members were taken from the executive, because in judiciary we find that the members were the Governor and the two members from his council. This way we find that there was no separation between judiciary as well as executive. This system, which I have already told you, that where the Governor took the place of the judge advocate and two other members of his council took the place of the other judges of the Admiralty Court, this lasted till 1692. But after that, John Dolben, he was sent from England as the judge advocate of Admiralty Court, but he too was dismissed in 1694. Like after 2 years only, he was dismissed from his job, and again, alas, the control went again into the hands of the Governor. After this, the Governor and Council, they become lazy, they become complacent, and they stopped to sit and handle the cases of this Admiralty Court regularly. And after this, they stopped sitting regularly to hear the cases. And this way we find that when judiciary and executive became one, the administration of justice suffered. Now let us look at the other provisions of the Charter of 1686. In the third phase, we also find that there was the establishment of municipal corporation in Madras Presidency. So we find that there was the establishment of Madras Corporation. This Madras Corporation, it is one of the oldest municipal corporations in the whole continent of Asia. Remember guys, this is an interesting factoid, that this Madras Corporation, Madras Municipal Corporation, it is one of the oldest and the first one to be built or constructed or established in the continent of Asia, not just in India, but in the whole continent of Asia, it might be one of the oldest. Now you may be wondering why this Madras Corporation was created. It was created to handle issues like sanitation, public health, education and other matters. The composition of this Madras Corporation was that it used to have one mayor, 12 aldermen and 60 to 120 burgesses. This mayor, it used to be always a English man. Never a native was appointed as the mayor of this corporation. Always the mayor used to be the Englishman. But we find that the governor and council, they had very little power in appointment and dismissal of these mayors and others. So what used to happen is that, first of all, the mayor and the council, they were not directly appointed by the governor and council. Therefore, there was no interference. And also, if the mayor and aldermen or burgesses, they were to be dismissed, then the governor and council, they had to give proper reasons for the removal. Otherwise, they could not be removed. And second, if the mayor and others, they found that their dismissal was malafide, that it did not, that the governor and council dismissed them in bad faith, then they could appeal to the higher authorities in England. So this way we find that the governor and council, it had very little powers in the appointment and dismissal of the mayor and aldermen. But this led to a huge friction and tussle for power between the mayor and aldermen and the governor and council. And later on we find that after a few years, another charter was passed which reduced the powers of mayor and his court drastically, and it increased the powers of governor and council. Now let us look at what were the provisions regarding the mayor's court made in this third phase of Madras Presidency. The mayor's court, it consisted of mayor and three senior most aldermen, and they acted as the justice of peace in this court. They decided all the civil as well as criminal cases, and they used jury only for the criminal cases. For civil cases, they did not need the jury. They decided the cases themselves. But for criminal cases, they needed the help of the jury. They used to sit once in 2 weeks, and they had the powers to punish a person with imprisonment or fine. The appeals from this court lay to the Admiralty Court, which I have already told you. And the judges of this court, like here you can see that they were the servants of the British East India Company, and that is why they did not have any legal knowledge. They were not lawyers, so they did not have any legal knowledge regarding how to deliver justice, how to hear the cases, what procedure should be followed. They did not know anything. That is why we find that they dispense justice on the basis of good conscience, equity and principle of fair play. And there was also provision made for the appointment of recorder of the court. And this recorder of the court, this office was first held by John Biggs. Remember guys, John Biggs was the judge advocate, the first judge advocate of Admiralty Court in Madras Presidency. Remember? And he was also simultaneously appointed as the recorder of Mayor's Court. But as we have seen that, he died sooner after that. Now let us see what happened to the Chaltry Court. As we have seen that Chaltry Court was kind of important institution or office in the first and second phase of the judicial administration. But in the third phase, we find that this court totally lost its importance. Nobody used to come to this court because its jurisdiction was reduced to such low standards that now it could only handle cases up to 2 pagodas. Earlier we find that it used to handle the cases up to 50 pagodas. But now, since its jurisdiction was reduced so drastically, it lost all its importance and significance. So guys, That is it for this video. If you like the video, please like, share and subscribe to my channel. And I will meet you guys in the next video. Bye bye. So let's look at the Admiralty Court.